Okay. Hi guys, Aris, Hardware Busters International. In QD OLED panels, a stack of blue OLED material lights up pixels that contain red and green quantum dots. Each OLED pixel has three sub-pixels, blue from the original blue OLED, red generated by red-tuned quantum dots, and a green pixel generated by a green-tuned quantum dot. All these three pixels, sub-pixels actually, can be combined to create a single white pixel. The significant advantage of QD OLED panels is that they can get much brighter than OLED ones while keeping an infinite contrast ratio thanks to the pure blacks they offer. Moreover, the color gamut is impressively broad, and Samsung, which is the force behind the QD OLED panels, promises for extended lifetime and minimal burn-in issues compared to OLED panels. The Dell Alienware 34-inch curved QD OLED uses this new Samsung 10-bit panel. The screen size is 34.18 inches and the curved screen is ideal for PC use. I was about to buy an OLED LG 48 inches, which was huge to use as a PC monitor, and the main reason I didn't do that is because it isn't curved. I believe that for a PC monitor, curved is the way to go. While on the contrary, in the TVs, curved wasn't so good idea. Anyway, the aspect ratio of this monitor is 21:9 and the native resolution is 3440 pixels by 1400 pixels. If you drive it through the display port that it has, 1.4, you will enjoy 175 Hz refresh rate. But through the plain HDMI 2 ports, you will be restricted to 100 Hz, which is a great shame. The price of this monitor is set at around $1,300 or 1,345 euros, and the provided warranty is 3 years. I want a more extended warranty given this price tag. Who does it refer to? Obviously, users with a lot of money who want one of the best monitors in today's market. If only it were larger, 38-inch, or even larger, 42-inch, keeping though the same aspect ratio. Bundle. It includes the power cord, since the monitor has an internal PSU and it doesn't use a power adapter, thankfully. One display port cable, one mini display port cable, one HDMI, and a USB 3.2 generation 1 upstream cable. External design and build quality. Typically for an Alienware product, the exterior design is modern and eye-catching. The monitor is large and the same goes for its depth. The build quality is high and the lighting at the backside, the Alienware logo and the light at the bottom look nice. You can control the lighting through the monitor's OSD menu. A large cover hides all cables and connections at the monitor's rear side, so everything looks neat and nice. Connectivity. There are two HDMI 2.0 ports, one display port 1.4, four downstream and one upstream USB 3 ports, one line out for audio and one headphone out port. Two USB ports now and the headphone jack are at the bottom side of the monitor, close to the OSD joystick for easier access, while the rest are on the backside. Ergonomics. There is a VESA mount 100x100 to use the monitor without its base and save some space on your office. We have height, swivel, tilt and slant adjustments regarding ergonomics, so only pivot is missing. Height can be adjusted by 110 mm, tilt is from minus 5 to plus 21 degrees and swivel from minus 20 to plus 20 degrees. There is a joystick to navigate through the OSD menu, making things easier. The OSD menu is complete and fast enough, but okay, you will need to get used to it to fully exploit it. That said, once you set the monitor in your preferred settings, most likely you won't bother at all with the OSD menu. The maximum resolution is 3440 by 1400 pixels with 175 Hz refresh rate. Still, keep in mind that you can only enjoy this resolution and refresh rate combination only through the display port 1.4 that the monitor has, and not through the HDMI ports, which are restricted to version 2 and not 2.1. So the HDMI ports don't allow higher than 100Hz refresh rates at this resolution. The laptop I used to test the monitor only had an HDMI output, so I couldn't fully exploit the monitor. The lack of HDMI 2.1 ports is a major disadvantage, unfortunately. Picture quality before calibration. If you don't have an instrument to calibrate your monitor, the best preset is the standard one. You need to increase though the brightness a bit to reach 200 nits, which is ideal for most users. After calibration, the differences in average and maximum delta E are huge. This is why you need guys to have a colorimeter to calibrate your monitor. I believe that people that will spend so much money buying a monitor like this, they have to see the two colors of the monitor. And the only way to do that is to have an instrument to calibrate it. Unfortunately, you cannot do that by using your eyes. Contrast ratio and brightness. The contrast ratio is infinite, so there isn't anything else to discuss in this section. The panel is not so bright in HDR mode, peaking at 238 nits. In HDR 400 mode, it exceeds 400 nits, while in HDR 1000, I was able to measure up to 879.38 nits in a small part of the screen. You cannot have such high brightness levels in the entire screen in HDR mode. Gamut coverage is terrific, and gamut volume is out of this world, especially in sRGB. I don't remember seeing any other monitor scoring so high readings in gamut volume. Panel uniformity. Panel uniformity. The average contrast and laminate deviations are very low. This monitor made my day during these measurements. Its panel truly is a state of the art, and kudos to Samsung for making it. Screen flickering. I noticed some voltage drops on the brightness signal at very low brightness levels, which no one will use, meaning that there is no screen flickering in real life conditions, so you should not be worried about that. Input lag is high at 17.6 milliseconds. The monitor's electronics have lots to do, as it seems, and it takes some time to process the incoming signals. The response times that I measured were extremely low, almost matching Alienware's claims. This panel puts to shame everything out there. It's simple as that. I haven't measured anything as fast till now. If QD-OLED brings so much, I'm eager to see some developments in this section, and especially in the burn-in issues, but let's talk about that later. I've run all LED busters tests, and the results were excellent, even at 100Hz, where I was stuck because of the HDMI 2 ports that the monitor has there. This is a problem for me. I cannot get over it that they have such a state-of-the-art monitor and they used HDMI 2 ports and not HDMI 2.1. Anyway, the viewing angles are impressive. There is nothing that can match OLED or QD OLED panels in this section. Even the IPS panels are far away, and there is no comparison, of course, with the VA panels. Reflections under strong light. The monitor is supposed to have an anti-reflective coating, but it doesn't do a good job, if it does have any at all. Not only is the light spread in a large area, but there is also a mirror effect. Now, if you plan to work on this monitor, make sure not to have a window beside you, else you will regret spending so much to buy it. I didn't notice any backlight leakage. After all, this monitor doesn't have an IPS panel, so there is no IPS glow either. In noise output, The monitor doesn't have speakers, but still I had to put it in the anechoic chamber that I have and measure its noise output because it has a cooling fan. With 12.8 dBA, I cannot say that the fan is loud, but okay, if you have a super hearing or something like that, you will probably get annoyed about that, because with the monitors, we come very close. We walk about half a meter distance, 1 meter at the tops. So it can be a problem. Another thing that worries me is that the cooling fan is a moving part, right? So a moving part into a monitor is another point of failure. Power consumption is high, and this is why probably the monitor needs a cooling fan to keep its electronics at normal temperatures. Unfortunately, I couldn't tear down the monitor. Dell Alienware would kill me, but I'm very curious to see what type of capacitors, for example, it uses, and the circuits, the build quality. This is something that we can do once we get bigger, our channel is larger, and we have access to more samples. Epilogue. This monitor screamed at me, buy me, from the first moment I saw it, but there's always a but. It lacks HDMI 2 ports. Its anti-reflective coating is a joke, a bad joke. It is only 34 inches while my current monitor is 38, and the provided warranty at 3 years doesn't make me feel confident about the lack of burning issues that Samsung claims about this type of panel. If Alienware were sure that the monitor is burning free, it would provide a 5-year warranty, at least. After all, you have to pay $1,300 to get it, so you need to be sure that there won't be any screen problems after 3 years, which is, it is not such an extended period. Pros: impressive technology, QD-OLED, high build quality, solid base that doesn't take much office space, good specs, high brightness levels, ultra-wide gamut coverage, USB 3.2 Generation 1 hub, G-Sync Ultimate support, HDR 400 and 1000 modes, ultra-fast panel, easy-to-use OSD menu, fair price given its specs, nice exterior design with cool lighting effects. Cons: it lacks HDMI 2.1 ports, high power consumption, the cooling fan is a point of failure, and I expected a lower input lag time. That was all. Thank you for watching another video by Hardware Busters International. Please subscribe to our channel to make us grow fast and provide you more stuff like this. We also have a Discord server if you want to join us there, and a Patreon page if you want to support us. Till the next time, bye bye.